Okay, it's taking a bit of time for us to start this show proper with our guest. We're having some technical challenges with the internet, network issues, but the engineers are working very seriously at it, and we're sure that we'll get back to the guest in a moment. You all welcome back to the program. It's Today with John and Helen. A calm and modest life brings more happiness than the pursuits of success combined with constant restlessness. That word, restlessness, says Albert Einstein. I think it's a great advice, John. When you ponder on dealing with everyday pressure, what do you think about that quote from Albert Einstein?
About restlessness?
Yes.
Restlessness is a result, you know, of influences, right?
Okay.
Is it influences now?
Which means it's external.
It's external, yeah. It's a reaction to what you feel from out there. You know, it's what works you up.
Mm.
It's when your adrenaline, you know, level goes up. You know, that you've heard about the fight or flight syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Where the body, you know, reacts or prepares you or anticipates, yeah. Anticipate something different.
Now you're talking body. Are you talking mind?
Yes.
Because it's the mind that controls.
Yeah, there's a connection to it, you know, because your mind now interprets the signals that it gets that, oh, there is likely to be an accident within that split second, you know, or a few minutes, and then, or something is going to happen. Okay, and then you start getting restless.
Something going to happen.
Yeah.
You see, a lot of the times, our restlessness and our pressure and the stress comes from our thinking about something that is going to happen.
Anticipation.
And a lot of the times, those things may not happen.
Yes. Now, are you talking about public?
But then you've gotten yourself on the other side.
Now, because
no, I'm not talking about public speaking. I'm talking about life generally.
Because that's what we teach.
In the last few weeks, I have been at a place that I haven't been in all of the years of my life. Really? And pretty much, I could say that majority of the anxiety, the fear, the pressure, the anger that I experience, you know, I can't say they were not, I couldn't feel them, but I imagined them and I allowed.
And this, you know, is a combination of experiences, right?
Yes.
Which now leads to anticipation, anxiety for something that you don't really, you don't really want to happen.
Yeah. And let me tell you something. The human mind, really, we hold on to more of the negatives. We think more about the bad things that are likely to happen.
It's a safety catch by the mind.
But does it do us so much good?
Well, at the end of the day, if you don't manage it well, it does you more harm than good.
All right.
You're turning me into a psychologist this morning,
exactly,
Helen.
Not exactly, because where we are this morning on this show, we must we must dig deeper, you know, to be able to let our viewers understand. Remember that on the show this morning, we're focusing on dealing with everyday pressure, so much pressure all around, and we're breaking it down to stress factors and the coping mechanisms if the guests will have any to share with us today.
I'm sure.
So now
will.
We're not alone on the show today as usual. Ferron, the lifestyle host, will join us later on with her guest. And don't forget, we have the Keep Fit coach and many more. And John's Nuggets?
Don't miss John's Nuggets.
Sorry, sir.
And this will be coming up
later
on when we round off the show. So well said, Helen.
Thank you, John.
Thanks so much for
remembering
my nugget at the beginning.
Your nugget helps. Mm.
So it's time now to bring in our guest again.
He's ready.
Yeah, are we sure he's ready now?
Let's see if the engineers have gotten him back.
Yes, but I'll just maybe introduce him.
Please go
you
ahead.
You know, he's an accredited management consultant who is also CEO and performance management consultant at New Neurons Concept. Mm-hmm. He is also a senior partner and
director
of learning at the Brainy Educare Services. He's deputy medical director, Marital Medical Center in Surulere, and a trained psychotherapist. Our guest today is also an author of the motivational book, I Am Loving This Math.
I'd like to read that book.
Yeah.
Someone
and he's also
maths.
A founder and president, Reviving Patriotic Values Initiative, which is an NGO passionate about youth development and nation building. Join us to welcome Dr. Fatai Olajobi. Dr. Fatai, you're welcome.
We believe this. Thank you, Dr. Fatai, for joining us. We believe that you will be helping us to deal with the pressures of everyday living. Good to have you on the show.
Okay, so Dr. Fatai, yes, we may strain our ears a bit to hear you because the audio is not very clean, but we have to deal with that pressure.
The show must go on.
We have to deal with that pressure as well. So I'll quickly dive on to our questions for you, Dr. Fatai. And I want you to imagine that the truck pusher, you know, and the limo driver live in the same city and they're exposed to the same stress factors. What would the effect of these factors be, or would the stress factors on the two of them be the same? Mm. These are people from different levels of life. Would the stress factors that they face be the same?
Yeah. So the stress factors are personal factors. There are other stresses that I will bring in the world. Our growing up experiences will determine the kind of reaction we're going to give to any factor that comes against us or to us. So whether it's a truck pusher or a truck driver or it's a human driver, what important is what the person is made of. You know, I want us to liken it to when you carry the car. And you know, I went to somebody who was carrying a car and somebody stopped him, jerked him, and exploded. And somebody asked the question, what happened? And he said he was pushed down by his children from the car. Okay. The person asking the question said, it doesn't matter whether you pushed or jerked, what happened was that popping scared out of the car. What is inside is what is going to affect our activity. If you have some people who may be driving the limo, they may be angry, they may be able to handle stress better. And someone else who is driving the same limo will not be able to handle the same stress as well. While someone who is driving truck may be able to handle stress, yet someone else who is pushing the truck may not be able to handle the stress factor.
You just talked about the stress factors for the different category of people, the truck pusher and the limo driver.
Yes.
The one living in Lekki and the one living in Ajegunle and all of that. Whether the stress factors for them are the same. Let's look at people who live in a town like Lagos and those who live in a town like my town.
It's a city, actually.
In Benue State. What level of stress do they expect, and what are the factors that are available to throw this stress level to them?
Hello.
All right, it's like
it looks
gone.
It looks like the audio. Wait. So you ask me.
Okay.
Me that
okay.
Question.
So I'm asking
but
you.
Don't promote Otupo.
Okay. So should I do Accra, your village?
Helen, come on.
Okay, so city. So let's talk about Lagos.
Let's talk about
Lagos, as big as it is, where everybody from every part of the world and this country reside. And we'll take a little, a smaller village, maybe somewhere in Enugu.
Anyway.
Since you don't want Benue now. Okay, so will the things throwing stress at them be the same?
Well, I think that the factors will vary, albeit you know, minimally in certain areas. Mm. Because no two locations are the same.
Okay.
You know, for instance, if you live on a hilltop, you're likely to feel cooler than if you live in a valley. I don't know, that's my own.
True.
So it's just a natural thing that, you may feel better slightly in terms of, you know, comfort and all of that from natural air and all of that when you're on the hilltop than in the valley. So if I use that analogy, apply it to all or most of the stress factors that we will feel, you know. And then again, there are certain influences that are external, even to locations.
Yeah.
For instance, someone living in Abeokuta will feel a bit of the stress factors imported from Lagos because of their proximity to Lagos.
Mm.
But if you probably move a little further down, the pressure reduces, right?
Okay.
So that impact is not as direct on the area that is further.
True.
That, so, well, I'm just trying to rationalize this, you know, in a logical way.
But we're talking about stress, the sources of stress.
Yes.
You know, you can identify a few of them. They come from the family. They come from finance.
Oh.
They come from your workplace. Okay? So, and some other sources. So some of these sources are available anywhere you find yourself.
Yeah, they are. And I'll give you an example.
Okay.
Last week, my phone.
Hmm.
My phone was going to do...
Up till now.
Even up till now. So what happened was I got into a frenzy. Because all of a sudden, I found out it wouldn't charge, right? And I needed the phone in another 2 hours.
Sure.
So there I was campering all around town looking for how to fix it. Now, let's go back 20 years ago.
How much of damage did that do to you?
Oh, it did. Generally. It, emotionally, stress-wise, it actually rocked me a bit.
And what solution did you proffer?
I ended up in what you call the GSM village.
Because life is about proffering solutions.
I tried to get it fixed within the short period. I thought I had about 2 hours, you know. So I tried to get it fixed. That was not possible. So what I did was to get something else that would charge it wireless.
Wow.
You know, so for the 2 hours, you know, I was destabilized. That was, for me, a source of stress that I couldn't avoid.
Mm.
But 20 years ago, I wouldn't have minded.
Yeah.
It wouldn't have hit me that much.
True. You know, and besides your phone going bad, you know, the telephone itself now and the internet, the fact that you are so open to a lot of distractions, you know, the calls are coming, the beeps are coming from text messages, from WhatsApp, from all of it.
It's even another source of stress.
It's another source of stress.
Yes.
It's, you know, a lot of the times the phones, is either the phones are on silent mode. If they are not, then they could get you.
Yeah, especially when you're expecting an alert from the bank. And then it becomes a stress point.
No, the stress thing is a serious one.
Yeah.
But I while getting ready for this show, I read a whole lot about stress and how to manage it.
Okay.
And it's calmed my nerves a lot.
Hmm.
All right. Hmm. We don't know whether our guest is back because the questions for this show are not for you and I, are they?
Well, it looks like you're prepared for it since you've read up so much about the factors.
If our director is there, if we can take a quick break, let's see whether we can get the guest back online. It's Today with John and Helen. We're looking at dealing with everyday pressure, stress factors, and the coping mechanism. Please don't go away.
Okay, thanks for being with us, and I think we've established a better connection now with
our guest
today, like you heard earlier on, is Dr. Fatai Olajobi. And of course, just to remind you of what we're discussing, and that is how to manage stress.
Dealing with everyday stress.
So, doctor, if you're still there, let's look at noise pollution in a city like Lagos. Now, there's no doubt that the stress from noise cannot be avoided. What are the implications of this? Could you tell us?
Okay, depending on the kind of noise it is, starting from challenges to the to hearing, okay, to the content of the noise itself, the kind of, if it is music, for example, or songs, the content of the song itself to the person, and then how the person synchronizes with what he hears, these are things that can affect the way the person reacts to the noise. Beyond the fact that noise itself can damage the ear and it can cause several challenges to emotions, the way the noise is interpreted matters a lot.
Okay. Sometimes they tell us that there are good stressors and there are bad ones. So we say the world is a global village, especially with the deluge of infotech and the internet. How much would you say this has contributed to stress factors in our environment, considering that you're both a medical doctor and a psychotherapist?
Okay, so the content in the internet is massive, and the upbringing of individuals depends on, or is going to affect how we react. The world is a global village, and there's a lot of things happening, and the way people take in these things that happen and interpret these things are dependent on their growing up. So an individual is groomed right from pregnancy. You see, the things an individual was exposed to in pregnancy, it will affect what will happen in any childhood, which will affect what happened later in childhood before teenage years, which will affect the teenage years and adulthood. And you see, the way people behave today, the way I react to things that happen around me is dependent on what's within me. So in the world today, people celebrate, even in Nigeria, for example, we celebrate a lot of, we celebrate cash a lot. We are probably beginning to rethink our ways, and the last time I saw a lot of news being shared about the girl that scored that won international math competition. You know, what people see in the world, what do we see? How do we see it? How do we want to interpret it? We see somebody come on social media and show up wealth, and we think that is success. It affects the way people react, the way they think, and the way they look down on themselves. The way they feel the hardship in their lives, and how the way they eventually react, and of course, depression, psychosis, and other things will come in depending on how individuals are able to interpret what is happening around them.
I'm sure that.
Am I still on?
Yes.
I'm sure that's talking to the threshold, varying threshold levels that we all have, as individuals. So. What would be a stressor or a serious stressor
for coping abilities
for Mr. A, it wouldn't necessarily be the same for Mr. B. So, Dr. Olajobi, let's take this conversation to the workplace and, the stress around the workspace. What would you say that... about the adoption of remote work, which we are now finding, most especially in the last 1 year, we're finding remote work happening all over the world. What would you say about it in terms of workspace? Has it reduced workspace stress?
In some ways, for those that are mindful before it has reduced workspace stress for them. But for some other people, it has worn what is it? Because what happens is you have access to your office 24/7. That is what remote work has brought us to. You have access to your workspace 24/7, and your boss, depending on how empathetic or how considerate he is or she is, would allow you to rest where you're supposed to rest, or would be would be over demanding if he's not mindful. So on one side, it has helped that you don't need to transport yourself, be in traffic, and then you save time and you save some money on transport, even though you spend money on a data to be on online. But at least you're able to save yourself of those other stress. On the other hand, there are people that are not mindful and they don't know that they need to make a choice of the gadget to use for their remote work. You don't use the same phone you use for chatting and other things. Because for some people, or for most of us, even adults and people that are up there, sometimes you get distracted because you get notifications. If you don't switch off your notifications, you get notifications and you want to check what message you have, particularly you're expecting some messages. You are in the office, you're not supposed to check any message. You just ask you in the fiscal office, and you're not supposed to open your phone and receive calls during work hours if you're not meant to. In some workplaces, you submit your phone. Yes, you submit your phone. But here, you're using your phone as your remote office. And so sometimes some messages come in and you want to check if you're listening. So there can be, there are pros and cons. And I think the advantages are more than the disadvantages if they are well honest.
All right, thank you so much, Doctor. At this point, I'm wondering, it's commonplace for a lot of people to tell you when they look at you one kind, you know, maybe you're not as bright as you used to be, and they say you're under some stress. Please either go and check for malaria, like you always go and check whether you have typhoid or malaria, or really what exactly is happening. Please tell us at this point, how do I know that I'm stressed? You know, or
what are the stress obvious,
is getting. What are the obvious symptoms and signs and proof, you know, that somebody is under a lot of stress?
Okay, so let's start from differentiating use stress, which is normal stress, from distress. So these are the two major forms, types of stress. The one you referred to it earlier. Use stress is normal stress. We need some level of challenge in life to keep us going and make us achieve our goal. But when it gets too much, that is distress. That's the kind of stress that we build to work for ourselves. And this kind of stress will cause trouble for us, both emotionally and physically. Because, you see, hypertension, for example, could be triggered by stress. And unfortunately, sometimes, most times, hypertension will not be picked except by chance when somebody goes by or routine medical checkup, or complaints of fever, and goes to the hospital and they check blood pressure, and blood pressure is high. So sometimes there may just not be anything. But when stress gets to a level, for me sometimes, when I'm in a class or training, and I'm not able to remember names, I know I'm under some stress. When you start forgetting some things that you normally would remember, you may be under stress. When you're getting tired too frequently, you may be under some stress. When you're having frequent headaches, unused joy, you may be under some stress. You need to check yourself. You will see what you were before and what you are now. When you get too irritable and unnecessary, you get home and you see your kids put things in the sitting room and then and you shout and you start punching or you start lashing at them, which you don't normally do. Maybe you're under some stress. You need to check yourself and take, you know, some break. Slow down. Okay, these are some of the things I can tell you now. Sometimes, for those that have us, trigger an attack of stress. I mean, stress can trigger an attack of ulcer. And some other physical illnesses, they're called psychosomatic illnesses. Some physical illnesses that are triggered, they're started off by emotions that are negative. So these are some of the things I can, you know, tell us now.
So now we have mental stress, we have physical stress, emotional stress, all kinds of stress. So which means generally that at some point or the other, you're exposed to some kind of stress.
Yes, at any point,
So, doctor, when that happens, where do we go to?
Is stress something that you can deal with as an individual, or you must seek help?
Yes. So I'll talk about it in two perspectives. One is preventive. The second one is corrective. So before you start feeling stressed, you need to be aware that you can get stressed. You need to maybe check yourself. Now that you're listening, you may need to check yourself and find out what were the things that probably predisposed you to stress in the past, And henceforth, how can you make efforts so that certain things will not, you know, affect you? Two ways. Either you don't get exposed to those things, to too much of those things that stress you in the past, or you train yourself to such an extent that you're able to handle it when it comes. For example, yes, you're working under a boss that is too demanding. It's either you allow yourself to get stressed up because of the demands, or you handle the demands by knowing that when you took up the job, these were the things you were told the job was going to involve. And we're told there will be deadlines. We're told sometimes some things will come up and we need to do them quickly. So I was told this. So I should be able to look for how to get it done. How can I get it done? What causes stress most times is when you fail to be mindful. When you're mindful, or when you move your emotional intelligence, you see, level of emotional intelligence also affects the way we react to stress. So you get to work and do something wrong and your boss is lashing at you and you feel it's just too inconsiderate. But you have done what is wrong. How should you take it? Sometimes you may not even have done what is wrong. But how should you react to a boss that's inconsiderate or that is rude? The best way to do it is, oh, what a pity. I didn't know this boss can be this rude. His growing up may have been so bad. Wow. Thank God. They are in one piece. I'm so sorry, sir. You see, I've told you before when I was working in civil service, I had a boss like that. I'm sorry, sir. And at the end of the day, they kind of say, just go in. You see, the way we react to it matters a lot too. So the way it pushes us down, or the way we react to it, the same thing we see, it is big. You see, the same job or the same challenges. Just the way, like the way Nigeria is now, a lot of financial challenges, a lot of frustration on the streets. But some people are still calm and are still going about their business. Some people have lost their jobs. You still see them. They are calm. You won't know that something has happened to them. Mm. Some people, they didn't lose their jobs. Their salary reduced. And they're so frustrated and they're cursing Nigeria and cursing everybody that comes their way. I'm not saying that things are good. Things are so bad. But the way you react to it matters a lot. How do I want to see it? What can I do for myself to improve my situation? Do I need to take a break? Mm. Do I need to think differently or work with some people? Or should I go and see a psychologist so that I can get better? These are the things you need to think about while trying to remove stress. Mm.
Mm. Yeah, doctor. Wow. Thank you so much for that
self-preservation.
Very deep explanation you've given to us. Yeah. But you see, the way our minds are conditioned now, I was telling Helen earlier on about the fight or flight syndrome. You know, where your body prepares for maybe the unexpected, or so. But you find that the truth is that 90% of what we stress ourselves over, you know, may not even matter a year from now. So why worry? That's the question.
Why worry?
Why don't we try to acquire the ability, you know, to decide what is important?
That is the key.
And stress over
what
it.
What is important?
You know, and then quit what's worrying important about things that we cannot control or change. You know, we need to be able to move on. You know, face only matters that matter.
Apart from that, doctor, as we round off this segment, are there some secrets, are there some things that individuals can do, families can engage in to reduce the level of everyday pressure?
So the first thing I tell people is perspective. We need to develop positive perspective to things. When challenges come, when distress comes, what we should do is What are the lessons in this for me? Mm-hmm. See, when people know, so that's the thing. In fact, before I talk about perspective, the first thing is there will always be challenges. There will always be stressors. Or there will be, except you know more living. The way someone has described it is, look at the way they act. If somebody is in the hospital and they are monitoring the well-being of the person, is in ICU, you will see the screen to go up and down, up and down. That's how life is. It goes up, it goes up and down. So when it goes up and down, then you know this. You are still living and things are moving. So you know there will be challenges. Number two, perspective. You must give positive perspective to everything that happens to you. Number three is you need to be patient. Persevere. Every successful person has a very high level of grit, perseverance. We say tough times never last, but tough people do. So when it's challenging, oh, sorry, I know this time is not going to last forever. I know this time. What we do? Have you watched this? Have you seen this movie? Three Idiots. Look at how the like, guy, it happens in life. That's how it is. So the way you handle it is very key. Be patient. Be turn the past. Number four is gratitude. And that's the biggest of them all. Gratitude. Every time there is stressor, just tell yourself, okay, this is stressor, but I'm grateful to God. It could have been worse. Wow. And if you are not godly, so I'm grateful. Be grateful. People that are atheists also practice gratitude. Gratitude takes you to higher altitude. Mm. What it does is give you a better perspective of life. Make your mind to be at peace. And you can do what matters in your life. Mm. Gratitude helps a lot.
Mm. Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, that's an excellent way to end it. You know, we're sitting down here alive. There are lots of people, you know, unjustly locked up in the prison somewhere. There are people who live in different difficult circumstances, you know, not of their own making. And so that word, gratitude, for whatever position you find yourself, and just encourage yourself that this too will pass away.
Yeah.
It can only be better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It could have been worse.
It could have been
like
worse.
Like Doctor says.
Yes. Thank you so much, Doctor, for your insights and your contribution. We're sorry for the small challenge we had, but we're grateful that we came through with it and you were able to do.
It could have been worse.
It could have been worse. So we're grateful that we made it this morning with you. Thank you so much. Thank you
so much, Doctor, for joining us.
Yes. All right.
So
we're moving on.
Yeah, let's keep going. I think by now, Pharaoh's segment will be warming up,
mm-hmm.
right? But for now, we will take on
our instructor.
Our instructor, yeah, that's the Keep Fit instructor.
Yes.
And join us when we get back.